Good evening and welcome to the Orleans Hotel and Casino. We're proud to be celebrating the 10th anniversary of this year's National Finals Tonight Show. Brought to you in part by Cinch, Prefert, Crown Royal Vanilla, Absolute, Bullet Bourbon, Jameson, 14 Hands Wines, Bud Light, Ram Rodeo, Neutrina, Boot Barn, Montana Silversmiths, Cactus Saddles, Big Tex Trailers, Resist All Hats, American Cowboy Magazine. National Finals tonight with 8-time world champion bull rider Don Gay, 8-time world champion cowboy Joe Beaver, and the men and women of the NFR. Sit back, relax, and enjoy National Finals tonight. And now, here's your host, award-winning television personality, Mr. Dan Miller.
Hi, everybody. We are so glad to have you here tonight. Round 5 is in the books now. We're halfway through this National Finals rodeo. How many went to the rodeo tonight? Very many of you went? Isn't it good? It's just been great this year. Tough enough to wear pink night, and we're honored to have you here with us here. This is our 10th season of doing National Finals tonight and our second year here at the Orleans Hotel. And we've got great people ready to come out and talk with you and to you. And let's first of all get our co-hosts. Actually, they're the stars. And let's get them both out here. They're 8-time world champions, both of them. The first guy, the best bull rider ever. And pink is his color. It matches his eyes. Donnie Gay is here. Donnie, come on out here, young man. Yeah. Try that again.
It's working. Hello.
How are you?
Okay, so I got...
Okay, Sean, we need number 2 for Donnie. That's the short microphone. It's good to have you here. Joe will bring it out for you. Donnie and I have been working together for 30 years now, and it's been one of the blessings of my life. I'll tell you that right straight up. Let's get this next guy out here. I'll tell you right before he gets here, he is bearing gifts.
I got so if you wave with Donnie.
Joe Beaver, give
once
him a
again,
hand. Yeah,
once
right
again,
there.
Once again, I have to help Donnie.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
All right.
Oh, we got it.
Donnie's been, hey, for those of you who don't know, Donnie's been having heck with this all week. All right, who's ready?
Night,
who's ready?
Okay, wind it up. Oh, you got to do better.
Right.
You want one, make some noise. We got the whole place ready. There we go. This is
right.
Not a golf tournament.
Somewhere.
Make some noise.
Somewhere tonight.
He's roping. Got to wind, loosen it up.
Oh, man. Nice.
Somewhere tonight, there's last year's pink shirt.
Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah. Pay attention.
Perfect.
Wow. Man, that was the third base. He's out.
Ha ha, you thought I was going over there with it, didn't you?
That arm's loosened up. You're ready to start roping
on
Thursday,
he's roping.
Aren't you?
Well, I mean, we got the board gaming shootout. Yeah.
She got the good one? Show them what you got.
She got her up.
Is that Kendall?
Yeah.
Hi, Kendall.
Show them what you got.
She
Hold
got
it up.
A beautiful pink shirt there.
She
That's
got the pink
awesome.
Shirt.
Beautiful.
Kendall, yeah. All right.
We are so glad
you
to have you.
You know he's
going
to try to sell you a roping horse, you know. So.
That's just opening the door.
If you would like to participate tonight, we'd love to have you. If you have questions that you would like to ask Donnie and Joe and any of our guests, it's easy to do. There's a text number that we will have right up there on the screen. We already have great questions coming in, but you can also send yours up. You can watch this on YouTube as well, the Boyd Gaming Rodeo channel. Check out that. Also, there's so much to do here. When we're done here, the bucking ball is going on here at the
That's
Orleans.
Right.
Yeah. We hope you take part in that as well. Let's do this. This is round 5 now, guys. We're halfway through, but I want to say this, Donnie, about the pink for Tough Enough to Wear Pink. That it's in every sport now, all over. But still, this guy right here, Joe Beaver, is the one. How many years? Joe started
it
all this. Joe started it
a long time ago. And Terry, you know, and she took it and ran with it and made it good. But my agent 1 year said, hey, you know, you were always asking, you're always taking. You got to give something back. And I said, well, what do you mean by giving back? He said, well, pick something that's dear to your heart or something, and let's raise some money. So my grandmother would have taught me which fork to use at dinner and what a finger bowl was. Donnie, you don't drink the finger bowl. So that my grandmother was one dear to me. She had breast cancer, went through it years ago when it was, you know, cut half your body off. And I always remembered that with her, and she's one that taught me the stuff I need to know. So we put a picture of me roping on pink T-shirts and sold them for $10 at my autograph deals around town. The first year, we give them $5,000. And, you know, after that, Terry Wheatley picked it up, and her family has fought breast cancer in every way you can imagine. Her sister, her daughters, everybody. And she got it, ran with it, and now it's a pretty big deal. But it started out with $10 T-shirts right here.
$10 T-shirts and a multi-million dollar deal right now. And that, yep, that is a big deal. And you know, I was at the Indian National Finals, and Joe B. started and really helped them and got them going with their diabetes foundation that really affects the Indian population.
Really
and
affects,
and
yeah,
it's just been, you know, it's interesting to watch, you know, what
watch
a guy can do if,
yep,
if you just kind of get it out there.
Yeah,
so
that's all we did. I mean, we talked
about
it one year.
So kudos to your agent was the one that had to teach you about giving instead of
he
taking.
Did.
Yeah.
He did.
Now
and
it's
then,
in every
and then after
sport.
That, he took plenty of mine.
Joe also has a blue feather in his hat, and this is a new thing for,
yeah,
children.
Yeah, they're in those bags out there. You should have a blue feather also. It's called Hope Counts. A little girl, 16 years old, came about on her own. She had a friend of hers that got hurt. The expenses were, you know, a lot for the family. So what it is they sell them. They raise money for the injured families of rodeo contestant kids. So if you got a blue feather, wear it. It's a good cause.
Very good, Joe. All right, let's get to it. We've got so many questions, but let's do this first. Donnie and Joe, of course, are doing the television live each evening for the performances of the National Finals Rodeo, but they're here to do it live for you. We put together a highlight reel of the winners, and this bareback riding was awesome tonight. Donnie, step up there, young man, and
all
kick
right.
it off.
Now, the bareback riding, this is two nights in a row. Jake Vold has put on a clinic. Hello, is anybody from Canada in here tonight? This guy has been riding so stinking good, really making the spur ride. This is a pen of nice horses. Last night, he won the go-around because everything was perfect. Look how the spurs come to the rigging all the way, every jump, his feet, his boots are at the 89 points, and it was so good, it was not even funny.
In the steer wrestling, we got a rookie on our end that's now won three go-arounds himself. J.D. Estrugnis, they weren't in a row, but, you know, they are. It's three in a row right now. This steer, the first night, ran a guy to the bucket chutes, and I said then, if anybody can get a good start, he's electric, he's light, he's going to go off. Watch this. When he hooks his nose, he's already cleared all 4 feet, 3.5. He takes another victory lap on a steer that got by some. In the team roping, here we go. How about 4.0? We had him on the show the other night, Junior. Caleb Dickers sticks it on this one. Junior changed horses, got back on his gray, and he healed that steer. Watch again. Dickers throws. The clock's on 0.2. Junior gets around this steer better. He doesn't cut in. The steer hops away. When he heals him, he just lays back.
Who was on the show last night?
Junior was on here. Now watch, when he heals him, if we can see him, he didn't start that. J.D. Yates, first man to ever do that. All right, now these Canadians, Duck Dynasty's let me down. He's roped two legs in a row. I saw him in the elevator today, and I said, Jeremy, cut that out. And tonight, Levi Simpson gets it on him. Now watch this. He's already throwing when this steer's feet come off the ground. When they go back to him, pretty shot. They did a great job of getting faced in the corner, but look at the clock was at 3.
Saddle Bronc riding the reigning champ of the world, Jacobs Crawley. He's got world champion, four-time world champion, Medicine Woman. He was 90 on him last year. He is showing you how to ride bucking horses this year. Frontier Rodeo bucking horse, Medicine Woman. Maybe one of the best mares ever to be in the Saddle Bronc riding. This is what they use on their judging seminar of setting your feet, straightening your legs, making a good bronc ride. 89 points, Saddle Bronc champ.
This is how a world champion bounces back. Last night, got a bad call. Shouldn't have been no time. Tonight, he comes back, makes him hold that slack, though, tonight. Spins him around, Rap Mahui. He is 6.7. People, that is fast. And watch this. This horse, he is phenomenal. He stops. You're going to watch the rope pull. But as this calf hits the ground, he doesn't move. Right there, he needs the help. Hey, I need 2 steps, horse. Gives him 2 steps. But when this calf hits the ground, you tell him, hey, don't move him. I'm throwing a wrap and a slap. And here it comes, 6.7. That's how you rebound. Jacobs Crowell did it tonight. Caleb Smith did it tonight. That's why they got gold buckles on their
gold
belts.
Gold buckle time.
Yeah, you came back down in the barrel race. Amberly, she might have come in 15th, but she's moving up. Now, money barrel's the first barrel, left barrel first. I've said it a million times. It's a better deal in the rodeo sometimes. When she turns his third barrel, watch the deal. The horse pushes straight away. He runs a direct line to the let-out gate. No blowing off. 1362. She is climbing up.
All right, the bull riding. It's been fun. Scotty Knapp, this guy has come to his first Wrangler National Finals rodeo. He's already been to the hospital. He's already gotten stitches. Spring the leg. He's already separated his shoulder. But guess what? He's a go-round winner tonight. 87 points under Dell Hall, Raptor H Bucking Bull. His free arm, see the right arm? Watch it not move very much, but he keeps it out here like just like this. Same kind of shirt, by the way. You know, he's got it right out there. That's because his shoulder's separated. He's having to ride this bull, but that was worth $26,000+
tonight. You take $26,000 and you rub on that separated shoulder, sure makes it feel better.
Outstanding. Good job, guys. Give them a hand, will you? Nice, Donnie and Joe. I tell you, we've had a lot of questions come in, and let me pick one out of here first for you, Joe. Let's go down to number four. It says, why are the tie-down ropers still allowed two throws at the Wrangler National Finals Rodeo when the team ropers do not get the third loop now?
You know, really, I don't know. The only thing I can say is, tonight, if y'all watched, there was almost a pretty good wreck. And wrecks sell. I mean, let's face it. And any time a guy pulls a second loop
nobody
out,
won't,
anything can happen.
Nobody wants you to have a wreck, but if you're going to have one, nobody wants to miss it.
They want to be there to see it. And tonight, we saw a guy run one through his loop, turn to run at his horse. Horse spun around, you know. I don't really know. I mean, it could be one loop just like the rest of the events. It makes it a little interesting, though, with two.
Okay, Donnie, here's another one. How many officials are there used at the Wrangler National Finals Rodeo?
Okay, so you have four that are marking down the scores like in the riding events. You have two judges behind the bucking chutes. They start the time. That's why sometimes you have a little disparity between the whistle and what you think's a qualified ride. It's all electronic. In the back, they're watching for fouls. But you have four marking the scores. So if I mark you 20-point ride, 20-point horse, that's 40 for Judge A, 40 for Judge B, blah, blah, blah. You get four of them, divide by two. We're still cowboys. You have to keep it simple.
Yep, I got it. Okay, we appreciate the question. Joe, let's answer this one as well, because the last two nights we've had guys DQ'd in the tie-down roping. Yep. They want to know who is responsible for calling that jerk down. Is there one specific judge?
You know, there's, and if you watched last night, there's a judge on each side of the arena now. And then there's the flag man. Last night for Marcus Costa, we saw one of the officials throw a flag. That means he thought it was a jerk down. But he was one of the side officials, and the main flagman overruled him. It's supposed to be all three agree. But I think sometimes it's just, you know, kind of reaction, because I don't see them all getting together and giving me thumbs very often.
Okay,
but
so
they're supposed to all three agree.
Used to be just the flagman.
Just the flagman.
Okay, so is it better now or worse?
You know, I have a lot of junior ropes, and I have breakaway. That's where you rope, and the rope pops away. Everybody wants to have a spotter at the back end to counter judge your judge. I hire the flagman to call what he sees, and I think the flagman needs to call it as he sees it.
Thank you very much.
You know, last night, the one guy threw the flag, and he didn't get him. But then Caleb Smith goes, and he's 7-7. Neither sideman throw a flag. And the flagman flags him out. Let the flagman call it like he sees it.
Period, the end. Somebody's got to be the bad guy. I mean, the buck stops here, is my opinion.
If, you know, pretty soon we're going to have eight of them all around the arena trying to
figure
shit out.
And none of them know what the hell they're doing. Oh, I'm not supposed to say that.
You cannot be so mean to the judges. Mm. Just because they're blind doesn't help, okay?
Okay. Oops.
Oops. This has been a great rodeo tonight, and we're anxious to get our first lady guest out here to visit with us. Yes, young lady, she's 20 years old and has got it going. Last year, she was the Rookie of the Year in the PRCA. Jackie Ganter is here. Would you welcome
young
her to National Finals tonight?
WPRA's finest.
Hi, young lady. It's good to have you here, huh? It's good to be 20 and be at the National Finals Rodeo, isn't it, huh?
You don't feel all alone, do you?
Hey, when you're pretty, young, and good, it's always bright lights. It doesn't matter where you're at.
We're glad you're here, Jackie. I want to start off, because this is tough enough to wear pink night, your mother. Yep. Your mother, breast cancer survivor. Could you talk about that?
Yes, breast cancer is a huge deal in my family. She got diagnosed in 2010, I believe, and she went through a lot of chemo and radiation and 9 surgeries. And so it was a lot for our family, but she overcame it. And she, this summer, she actually finished up her last bit of chemo. She was on a pill for 5 years, and so she's officially in remission now.
How about that, huh?
Yeah. Amazing.
Where is she?
Amazing.
Here?
Yes.
She make it?
She's somewhere.
Where are you at?
And it's a huge strain on all of the family, isn't it?
Yes, for sure. It was, yeah, my dad passed away when I was 8, so it was my grandparents. I live in Abilene, where they live, and so it was my grandparents helped a lot. They were around a lot, and kind of whole family came together, so.
It was a fight that y'all won.
Yes, for sure.
I like stories that end that way. This has been a great year for you. You've been ranked in the top 5 all year long, young lady. And the rookie of the year last year, you were in Calgary. All your dreams are kind of coming true here in the rodeo business for you. We've got a couple of your runs queued up that we want to take a look at and have you comment along with Joe on. And I think this first one is from round number 3, Jackie. So I know you've got 4 horses at least. We're going to talk about them, but let's talk about this run right here.
This is the best run I made. This is kind of my older horse. He finally nailed the first. Well, I nailed the first. He smokes the second every time. His third, he kind of always steps off of it like that. He did it kind of less. He's awesome. I've always wanted to run him here. I rode him back in 2013 for some people, and I just got the chance to get him back this summer, and so it was really exciting. He's 18 years old. Wow. I know, and so he's, you know, to come here and compete with all the younger horses that are at the top of their game in their prime, to still be running with them was huge.
You know how a horse catches your eye and he just smokes a run down somewhere, and you think, wow, you know? I don't know how many times you'd run him before Texarkana, but is that the same one it was at Texarkana?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm watching, you know, and just kind of half-ass paying attention like always, and man, just, I'm like, man, that's a bad horse. So she comes out, I'm like, hey, Jackie, where'd you get that one? Is that a colt? She's like, no, he's no colt. I said, how old is he? She said, 18. I said, he can run him at the finals? She said, I'm planning on it. That's what I'm looking for. And I thought he made a nice run right there. Now, you said he nailed the first barrel, then you said, oh, I nailed the first barrel. People have no idea the angle and how fast that first barrel comes up at this rodeo, do they?
Oh, it's unbelievable. The first barrel here is the hardest first barrel of the entire year by far. Stevie Hillman and I were actually talking about it. I was trying to tell her how to nail it, and then I thought I needed to tell myself. But
but it paid off because she finally nailed it tonight,
she
too.
Did.
That's the first night, really, that she's got it nailed out.
So she was excited. She actually tried what I told her, and it worked. So
you might want to try that rest of
the week. I know. I need to try it. I need to take my own advice. But it's hard. It's different here, for sure.
Well, last year, you know, we talked about it on stage a couple times. Well, you know, it was a battle between a rookie and a rookie, and it came down the end and stayed off all the barrels and won second or third and that, won the rookie of the year, made the finals the first year. You know, to do that, and I've said it before, and Donnie and I agree a lot on this, about the people, y'all don't understand. This is the hardest event in rodeo. Not the roughest, not the toughest. It is the toughest, but it's the hardest event because they don't fly much. You know, they didn't send the horses around every now and then. But first of all, they're so damn picky that they won't send them off with people like I did. If you had a trailer and a truck, I'd send mine with you because I could fly. Donnie flew everywhere. I mean, second of all, the ground. You can't control outdoor arenas when the weather's bad. You know, so the ground gets involved. You know, and then it might be wetter in the mornings and not at night. So to make it and get your rookie year, but to come back and do it in high cotton, does it feel like you're kind of getting it accomplished?
It does. This year I felt like it went a lot smoother. I felt like I won more consistently. There was still rough patches, but I didn't have so many downtimes like I did last year. I would go weeks on end without winning anything. And this year I felt like I kind of tried to even it out a little bit more. I won a lot more in the winter. So I got in the winter rodeos. I didn't even get in those last year at my rookie year. So that helped a lot because there's a lot of money to be won at those. And then throughout the summer, I kind of gave the horse that I won so much on in the winter, my stud, again, I gave him a break. And my good horse that got me to the finals the year before, he had broken his hock, and he came back, and he won for the rest of the summer. He won, I think, 30,000 in maybe 2 months. And so it was pretty
unreal.
He
came back good.
He did. He came back almost, I honestly think he came back better than he was before.
So do you have a schedule whenever you go to change horses during the year? And then what about at the finals? Do you, if you have a two or three horses here at the NFR, what
five.
Makes
five
how
horses?
How many?
We did the preview show.
Well, hell,
show.
I'd have, heck, feeding them.
Well, we did
so,
the preview show.
So when
show,
do you know you when you're going to run one? I mean, what constitutes a change?
This summer, I kind of rely on Jet, my buckskin that I rode here last year, because he's kind of Old Faithful. He'll run in any arena, big, small, it doesn't really matter. And so I'd ran him all winter and a little bit of into the summer, and I just thought that he deserved a break. I was pretty much into the finals, and so I went ahead and sent him home. And I thought that if I needed to fly home to some rodeos, that I'd run him to keep him running. And Baby Jay had just come back from his hock injury. And so I thought he needed to run again. And then I have another horse, Cartel. He's helped me make it both years, but he kind of needed to step up. And so I ran him some and got a little bit more confident in him. And I kind of just based my summer off of what arenas I thought would fit him better. And then coming here, I wanted to ride my old horse. That was my plan. We got him back just, you know, right at Texarkana. And so I rode him the first four rounds, and he had a little bit of trouble with the ground. The third round, he did awesome. And the other three I ran him in, he kind of struggled with the ground a little bit. And so tonight I actually got on Baby Jay, and he did good for his first run ever in this arena. He's younger, and it's a lot to
take
in.
Will you stay on him?
I don't know.
Let's take a look.
I have no idea.
Let's take
Let's
a look
watch.
At it, Joe.
Let's
We've
watch
got
tonight.
This one
have
from
Have you seen
tonight.
This yet tonight?
I've watched it, my grandma's video.
All right, watch this. Tell me, because I thought I liked it because he was running. You know, and if they're
we
not running in here.
we were going very fast.
Well, that
fast.
First barrel, we're going to talk. Well, you got it figured out now. All right, watch, see. Let's see.
That I missed my first a little bit. Just I should have bumped him a little sooner. Second, I don't know. He kind of just scrambled on the backside. Third, he cut me off a little bit, and it kind of threw him out on the backside. He does that sometimes. And outdoor, he can make up for it. Indoor, it's a little bit harder to make up for it. He's very fast. He had over 100 speed index on the racetrack. And so in this kind of situation, stuff like that, though, it hurts you, because if you're in an outdoor arena, he's fast enough that he makes up for it. In a little pen, a horse that turns and isn't as fast as him is going to outrun him.
He can run himself out of it outside.
He can.
In the big arenas.
He can make up
and
for
here's
his
the deal.
Mistakes.
Okay, let's just say, okay, let's figure. Okay, that's a tick, tick, you know.
Yes.
In the second barrel right there, you felt him trying, you kind of got him outside. There's a tick, tick.
That probably cost me the most. He usually turns the second pretty good. Third, he'll kind of do that sometimes.
Yeah, but he runs out of it.
He does.
But
he never stops running.
Let's just say the first and second barrel is five ticks. Five ticks on that clock is fast. It moves you right on up. So not bad for the first time you ran here.
No, I was proud of him. He's seven, and so he's relatively young to be running at the NFR, and it's a huge stage, bright lights, huge crowd, and he's really more of an outdoor horse. And so for him to step up and clock like he did, I was proud of him.
You're doing very
so,
well here.
So
go
let
ahead,
me tell you something. Okay, you may not know I know this, but anyway.
Oh, no.
So, you know, all of us have our own ways of dealing with not winning well. You know, show me a good loser and I'll show you a loser. He doesn't care. She doesn't care. All right? So anyway, last night, you know, everybody gets to the rodeo. They go to dinner and they enjoy themselves, or they go out or whatever. And Jackie Ann had the greatest first four rounds. So guess where you could have found her last night, Donnie? In the practice pen till midnight, cruising around on her horses trying to get her game back. That's the difference in a winner and a loser right there, people. That's what it takes to go 8 months and to go 12-hour drives and no changing horses to the arenas. That's the difference in a winner and a loser, dear. If you keep doing that, figure it out, and get the first barrel down, it's going to be ugly.
Thank you. I was very, very disappointed with what happened last night, and I thought that there was a lot of things I could have changed, so I went back to my horses. That was the first time I've done that. Every night I've just gone back to my hotel room and seen my family. Last night I rode with the girl that handles my horses. I went to the place that we stay at, and I saddled up everything and rode. So I thought I needed to ride, be calm by myself.
That's just what you do, because in the end, when you drive, when you start driving home, when this rodeo's over with, as long as you know that you did everything that you could do to have the best outcome that you could have, then that's okay. That's good enough. Yep. And it doesn't matter whether you got the gold buckle or not. It's as long as you know.
You don't want to leave nothing in the field.
Nothing on the table. There's nothing left
in
the tank.
And that's one thing I can say about this girl from little. You know, she's ridden all kind of horses. She's done everything, but she doesn't leave it in the arena.
And she's wearing her good luck charm, right, Jackie? One of the camera guys over here, or with the jib, if you can get a shot of her necklace here. Tell us the story behind that. Is this necklace?
I have a necklace that my mom gave me the day that I filled my permit. And I was at the All-American Pro Rodeo Finals not too long ago. It was between the end of the season and the NFR. And I was leading my stud horse, and I had, I think, 10 buckets in over my shoulder. And I had my arms full. My stud was pulling on me, and he was trying to eat. And he jerked me down, and the buckets hung, and it ripped my necklace off.
Wow.
And so it broke the chain, but I still have it, so I need to get it fixed. But I'm not wearing it right now because it did break. I did bring it with me, at least, so I have it with me when I run, but I don't have it on.
Her other good luck thing, Donnie, is talking to horses and kissing them on the nose. So
put that in your right front pocket tomorrow to remind you about that first barrel.
Oh, I agree.
Last thing I want to say to Jackie, and we'll let her go here this evening, it's such a wonderful sport that Jackie is now 20 and Mary Berger is 68, and they're competing against each other on level ground. And I love that about the barrel racing. Doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are.
You know what that old saying? Oh, what a difference a horse makes. The good ones you can win on whatever age, the bad ones, if you're the number one jockey in the world, it's like taking a Volkswagen to the Indy 500. They're going to zoom by you pretty fast.
You know, and there is something to say about being in the race, but you know you do want to win.
Yes, sir.
Jackie, we thank you for coming out. It's so nice to meet you. And 5 rounds left for this young lady. Give her a hand, would you please?
Thank you.
Jackie Ganter.
We just keep hitting the youth in the future rodeo. I mean, you know, and we've had some conversations this week, and, you know, a lot of people have said, boy, you miss this, and you miss them not being here and this and that for whatever reason they're not. You know, no. We got youth. We got 30-something rookies.
Oh,
we got rookies winning. I think this national finals is about as good as it's been, don't y'all?
I do too, Joe.
Well, I mean, you know, so I always thought it was kind of funny. I mean, of course, you know, when I was riding bulls, I thought everybody was at the rodeo to watch me. I mean, I'll go ahead and admit it. You know, I really did. You know, so when you're 90 points in the bull riding or the bareback riding or the bronc riding, or you're 6-7 in the tie-down roping, are you going to cheer any louder because I scored the 90 or he was 6-7, or are you going to cheer for the 90 and the 6-7? And that's just that. If it was just me, when I retired, everybody would quit watching bull riding, and it didn't happen.
The ratings went up.
So I mean, I had to look in the mirror and go, "Oh God."
Well, I was just going to say, tonight was the 305th consecutive sellout. Yeah. Still the toughest ticket in town.
We didn't sell any more tickets.
Hey, what do we? How many rookies have won go-arounds, you know? I mean, it's like Donnie said. They go, you know, we play for
you know, you enter the rodeo, and just because you're the world champion doesn't mean you're going to win a dime. The Bulls don't read your resume.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares.
Well, Jackie's 20. This young man coming out is 22. And as I mentioned, this is our 10th year of doing this show. When we started doing National Finals Tonight, Jackie was 10 years old and back in third grade, you know. And so...
Will you stop that?
Yeah. Well, Donnie's a lot older than Joe and I. But anyway, this guy is 22 years of age. He's in the bull riding, and the guy is on a streak right now, Donnie. Yeah. He's put in two really good rides the last two nights, won a ton of money last night. Brennan Eldred is here. Would you give him a hand? Come on out here, Brennan.
Come on out here, cowboy. Thank you, sir. All right.
Welcome, Brennan. It's good to have you here. Third
time. Y'all saw how tall he was, didn't you?
Did you want to stand up? Did you want to do that? Now, Brendan, this is your third time here at the National Finals Rodeo, and as I mentioned to you back last night, what an outstanding ride for you. You've got things going now. Talk about how this NFR is feeling to you.
Thank you. Yeah, this NFR, it's definitely kicked off a lot better than the last two. You know, that wasn't hard to beat, but, you know, it's a new year. I'm feeling good. You know, I've been really working hard at it and putting in the time and the effort, and, you know, I'm just feeling good.
You're feeling good and you're looking good. I mentioned last night, let's go ahead and take a look at it, you and Donnie. This won the round last night. You got some money in your pocket. Life is good.
Okay, so now tell them the circumstances. Is this when you got the re-ride and they got to run this bull in? You had another bull drawn, couldn't get out on him. They make you take a re-ride. And they run him in and say, okay, it's your turn. And you don't ride one any better than that.
Thank you. Yeah, my first bull was a little bad in the chute, and the judge is here. You know, they don't deal with that stuff. So I tried him twice, got out, and I didn't even have time to retake my glove on. And, you know, it was just all so fast. He was already loaded, and I pretty much stepped over the chute and got on him.
I'm thinking if that wasn't a good thing.
Well, I
no
mean,
time
it,
to think
and
about
it. Sometimes those are the things that, you know, when you're clear-minded enough to take advantage of the situation that's in front of you. I mean, you just don't ride a bull any better. Spurring with the outside foot, you're in time. There's a lot going on, but, you know, you waited on the bull. You got your rhythm right out of the gate, and just an awesome ride and never even thought about it. Tell people what it's like sitting and waiting till you're next.
That's one of the toughest parts. And last night, it kind of worked out in my favor, I feel like, because, you know, I didn't have time to think about what the bull was going to do or really what bull I had, you know. And most of the time that works out into your favor, you know. You don't have time to, you know, set a trap or something, you know. The bulls, you got to ride them jump for jump, and, you know, they can always have a different trip. But I like that, you know, just, you know, not knowing a whole lot about the bull that I'm getting on, or, you know. And I feel like it worked out in my favor last night.
Let's well, take a look
I,
at tonight, pick,
I picked you in the top four, and I think I missed it by a little bit whenever you told me what. But let's watch tonight's bull ride. So you won the go-around last night, and you're thinking, well, I got things kind of turned around a little bit, so you have time. Talk about this bull and this bull ride.
Jay Lazy, Raptor G bull. I've seen him all year long. He's a great bull. They haven't rode him a whole lot, but every time they have, they've won on him, won around at Cheyenne on him. Really, really great bull, and I was super stoked to have him tonight. Turn back right there to the left, away from my hand. Every time I've seen him, he's went right. But, that's a bucking bull for you. You can't set a trap for him, and you just got to ride jump for jump.
Well, my brother Jim named him Jay Lazy, and that's named after, you know, my second father, Jim Shoulders, the Jay Lazy S brand. And that bull, I've seen him 50 times over the last two or three years, and he's always gone to the right. I didn't go to the short go at Fort Worth. The only time he went to the left before tonight. And so that's just what these bulls do. And, you know, and a testament, because I know everybody in the locker room and every film that they showed showed you he's going right, but you can't get caught in your own trap. And I was just doubly impressed, but I was disappointed in the score because you won what place?
I believe I ended up fifth.
I think you wound up fifth. I said you'd be in one through four, so we'll give the judges a little bit of slack. They rode some good bulls tonight. Y'all look like what I envisioned starting out the first night, carrying on through. Tonight, I think it bodes well to come because I think everybody's got the cobwebs out. The only bad thing is Cody Teal breaking his collarbone. He's out for the week. And hadn't ridden a bull, got married before the first performance, and I know there's nobody in Las Vegas any more disappointed than Cody Teal, but has nothing to do with him getting married. It's just this rodeo is different.
Hey, and he said he got married in Vegas because everything's always good for him in Vegas.
It's been so good.
He's won hundreds of thousands of dollars, but you might have just really put that into perspective. You know,
I don't know what
Cody's thinking positive. Donnie's thinking that this just didn't work.
Well, you know, that's not why he got hurt, but you know, I mean, if you watch the news, you know, if there's not any news, you make something up.
You know, Donnie actually went to college to be a family counselor, and for some reason that didn't pan out.
And that's why he rode bulls, because of clout.
Oh, my. Brendan, from the time you were 6 years old, you've been a wrestler and done it at the state level and national level, came in second as well. It seems like with Ken and AC, all the wrestlers seem, I think, to do well with the balance and everything that comes with this bull riding. Do you feel like it's helped you, any of that background for you?
Oh, most definitely. You know, I've done every sport you can imagine growing up, and I've done it all, and I think every sport, anything extra you can do is always somewhere down the road going to help you out, you know. And I've just always, you know, worked out wrestling or football or baseball, whatever, and just always kept me in good shape. And I feel like, yeah, it helped me out big time in my career.
Okay, so you won about how much money so far in this year in the PRCA? What, how much money coming in and what you've won now, kind of what, how much is that?
I'm probably around $160,000 now after this.
Okay, so the CBR, how much more in the CBR this past year? You had a great year.
Yeah, I won $70,000 or $80,000 alone in the CBR.
So this is, it is such a wonderful time. If you really like to ride bulls,
you can ride them for a lot of money.
You can ride for a lot of money. I mean, because there's opportunity. I'm a PRCA guy, but the PBR and the CBR. The PBR, you just almost have to stay. Proctor has worked the system as well as I've ever seen, but, you know, there's so much money. How many bulls are you getting on a year, the last 3 years?
I've averaged, I would say, 140 to 150, you know, past couple years, I've been to 70 to 80 rodeos, and then the CBR is on top of that. We got 15 events there, and, you know, most of the time I'm getting on three of them. So I'm probably averaging 140, 150 head a year.
This young guy right here is he is the face of professional bull riding in my estimation. And you know, my hat's off to him because there's a lot of other things that pull you one way, pull you the other way. But what it really does is it's so easy to get your focus untuned, blown up. And I'm really glad for you guys because it's a hard way to make a living. I mean, when you go to try to get insurance and you tell them you're a bull rider and you're thinking about becoming a pilot, it ain't affordable. It's tough.
Yeah. Brendan, what I want to, before we say goodbye to him here this evening, what you may not know looking at this young man, he loves hip-hop music. Is that the deal with you? Is that true, or is that?
Yeah, I like a little hip-hop.
Can you do any beatbox?
It gets my motor running, you know, but I like rock and roll, too, when it's bull riding time. You know, that's what really gets me fired up.
Yeah, I love it. The guys that are the back there have their headphones and different things going on. This man is off to a great start here at the National Finals Rodeo this year. Got some money in his pocket. He's a good young man, as you can see, 22 years of age. It's an honor for
You're
us.
You're going to keep seeing him. Yeah. So, Brandon Eldred, y'all put your hands
Give him
together.
A hand, would you please? I mean, yes.
This is a face of bull riding right here because he's the real deal. Does not stop.
It just does not stop. I mean, if you're not pumped up about the future rodeo with the people we've had on this week, then you've been watching Donnie too long, too many tapes.
Some of that's old. Yeah, but I, you know, I just don't like the hip hop. I mean, you know, but I asked him about Alice Cooper, and he had the funniest look on his face.
You know what, Dan? I bet he didn't really care what he thought about it.
No. Like Donnie's the only one still that's a fan club member of Ricky and the Red Streaks, and so that's...
I actually told a lady, and I hate to say this, man, a lady from Colorado texted me and said, going to the finals, hadn't been in 20 years, where do Ricky and the Red Streaks play now? And I text back, I thought he was dead. And they sent me a picture of him, and he says, won't be there this year. He's propped up. Got hip replacement. Be back next year.
There's hope for all of us.
I know that they actually had to change their name now to the Brown Streaks as they're getting older, but let's get this last guy out here.
Oh, boy.
Well, at least he'll be madder at you than me.
Yeah. We're so glad to have this next gentleman here with us, and I'm going to have everybody come out so that we can have a really good rodeo discussion. You can say what you will, good, bad, love. This man has steered the PRCA through some rough waters here in the last few years.
In the right path.
And I'm proud of him. I'm proud of him for doing that. The commissioner is here, Carl Stressman. Would you give him a hand? Hello, Carl.
Good to see you. All right, the boss man.
Come on in here. Bob and Boyd, if you're back there, come on out, would you please? Get everybody out here. Carl, have a seat right there, if you will. Joe, Bob's coming out right now. Joe, do you want to come on? We'll get another couple of chairs out here to do that. Robert, have a seat right over there by
Dan, he's got them ganging up on you now. We got the Killer Bees coming.
Go ahead,
Bob
Joe. He's got
Tallman,
a chair for you over there.
Boyd, Paul Hamus.
I haven't seen Boyd yet.
Uh-oh.
Do you want to grab that one over there, Joe, and we'll... Well, good. There you go. And then when Boyd gets here, we're all set. Carl, it's so good to have you here with us this evening. I know it's a busy week for you, and we're glad to have you here with us tonight. Everybody wants to talk to you because there's so much to talk about. So we're going to talk about the health of the PRCA. And what I said when I introduced you, I meant that. We're so glad. It's been quite a year for you. Talk about it if you would, Carl.
Well, it hadn't been the easiest year that we've had in the PRCA probably, but... I think it's certainly been a learning experience for everybody, and I think we came out the back end of it pretty darn strong. We've had a really, really good year at the PRCA financially and lots of other ways, and you know, you learn by adversity, I think, and I think we certainly have learned a lesson, and that is, you know what, you do stand up for what you believe in. The PRCA is a very strong organization, and we are in a process of making sure that we continue that strength in the PRCA and give people opportunity. We're opportunity providers. That's what we do for a living. That's what the PRCA is, opportunity providers.
As I mentioned just before you came out, it's still sold out, 305 performances in a row. People are here because they love rodeo. People come here without tickets because they love rodeo and this family get-together that I did an interview with the station back in Cody today, and I just said, it's the sport, it's the sport, it's the sport, and people came here to see that. You've got an extension now through 2024 to stay in Las Vegas. Tell us more details about that. Well, yeah, give them a hand. This is where this needs to be.
I mean, it's where it needs to be.
This needs to be, and that was also a part of your last couple of years, keeping it here. That to me... Boyd, come on out here beside me. They just told me in my ear that Boyd is here. Come on out here, Boyd. That, to me, was maybe one of the trickiest things, and my hat's off to you for that. It needs to be here in Las Vegas. But with that 2020, give Boyd a hand, if you will, please, right there. With that extension to 2024, are there money things built into that as well, that extension, Carl?
Did you say, are there money things?
Prize money built into that extension.
Prize money goes up after the fifth year. According to the consumer index, whatever that's happening. So I don't know whether it be 2%, 3%, whatever it's going to be. But we'll get a raise for the contestants after the five-year period of time. We gave them 5 years. Because of the increase went from 6.3 to 10 million, then we gave them a little time to recover. It was a very, very interesting negotiation through that period of time when we were trying to see, you know, feel the temperature of other places as to where the national finals could possibly have gone. And obviously today I can sit up here and tell you that I'm thrilled that it's in Vegas, that this is where it should be. 2 years ago, I wouldn't have said that to you because the negotiations were tough, very frankly. And we had the PRCA over all the years, I think this is the first time that it's held its ground and said, hold on, we're not coming back to Vegas. I don't know exactly if we meant that or not, but we had other opportunities out there in the marketplace, and I think there's still opportunity out there, who knows what the future looks like. But I can guarantee you one thing, the next contract won't be negotiated by this commissioner because he won't be here.
I was just going to say 2024.
Well, 2024, that's pretty good. But I will say this. Now, you know, everybody is just dying to say, well, you know, this has been a little bit of a rough year internally because of the ERA. Sure. Okay, so, you know, what I always try to say, because I'm a PRCA guy, and I've grown up my entire life, and the PRCA is a membership-based organization, and if you pay your $450 is all it costs, if you've filled a permit and you're qualified, you can buy your card, but you can buy that fella in the front row, if he pays $450 for his card, an 08-time world champion pays $450 for his card, our vote counts the same. We're no different. This is not a players union like the NFL, NBA. It's apples and oranges, and I thought the PRCA stood its ground, let everybody know that, you know, you have a right to have membership in this association, and if you have it, you need to go by our rules, and you can't be suing us and be a detriment, or you get set out. And I thought it's worked out, and there's not really any animosity. Guys that want to come back, come on back. But you know what? Okay, go ahead, Boyd.
When he was renegotiating this contract, one of the things he said is he would say to them, if you don't give us the money we're asking for, I'm going to take, now listen to my words here carefully and the names carefully. I'm going to take Trevor Brazil, Casey Field, Luke Branquino, Tuff Cooper, and we're going to go someplace else. And the fans of these guys, Trevor Brazil, Tuff Cooper, Luke Branquino, Casey Field, will follow us. And therefore, Vegas, even if you decide that you're going to have your own invitational rodeo, because we leave as the PRCA, we're taking our stars with us, and that will hurt you. My humble opinion is, for whatever reasons, those members of the ERA decided they needed to go, which I will just tell you, it kind of broke my heart after him and my rep on the board, Benji Bendley, and other people stuck their neck out to get as much money as they could out of Vegas, and what they were wanting were these elite rodeos, pardon the pun. We already had them. They were called the Wrangler Champions Challenge. They were knocking out 90% of the membership so that only the top 10 or 11 in each event would have a chance at dollars that counted toward the NFR. But now, remember, we're in our second year on this contract, so we're 7 years away from having to start negotiation on a new one. And if we come to them now and say, you don't give us what we want, we'll take Tim O'Connell, Tyler Wagus back, Luke Brown, Jake Long, Jacobs Crawley, and we'll go somewhere else. They're going to go, yeah, I ain't buying it. Because those guys went somewhere else, and they didn't sell any tickets. So, in truth, the biggest damage the ERA has cost the PRCA is negotiating strength. Do you understand? It's cost us negotiating strength. And that's to me, the underlining, regardless of the reasons you want to go try to put your own event together, in the end, we will pay for their decision to attempt this endeavor because one of our chips has been pulled off the table that we were using, or Carl was using at the time. And when he came up to me in Denver, after it was agreed that the NFR had ended in our final year of our contract, we did not have a deal on the table. And I'm thinking, and I told him, I said, man, if Las Vegas says no, and they decide to spend enough money to guarantee Luke and Casey and all that, that you come here, I'll give you $50,000 to ride my rodeo. Forget about the national finals in Florida or Oklahoma or Dallas or wherever it might have been. You stay here. I was afraid it was going to splinter our association even further. That was my number one fear, because I knew the fan base had a great affection for Las Vegas, and I was just scared. And when he and Allie showed up at Denver to tell me it was done, I turned around and I looked at him and I said, you beat gamblers at their own game. You beat gamblers at their own game, because I think Las Vegas could have went that way, and yeah, and they beat him at their own game.
He deserves a round of applause, because he's been right. He's been discussed and cussed in a lot of different corners, and in mine too. But I will say this, you know, he did what I didn't think he was going to get done, and he got it done. He was right.
Bumped into him and Allie going to the Boyd Gaming booth to sign autographs on Saturday. And he asked me if I'd seen some of the players from the RA that have been out here but obviously aren't competing. And I said yes. And this was my exact words to him, and you all tell me if I'm wrong. Their number one mistake, while they are stars, and they are deeply, very talented, and the records that they've set in our association are still in the media guide, the championships that they won in our association are still in the media guide, their fundamental flaw was they thought that they made the NFR. But in truth, it was the NFR that made them.
Amen.
There you go. And the
it made
difference
us all. And the minute you think it didn't make us all.
All of us.
All of us.
Boyd,
sitting here,
Bob, Joe, every one of us.
The minute you think you made that without the PRCA and without the national finals, you have problems and you go somewhere else. And guess what you realize? Your problem. It made us. We didn't make it.
Yeah. 12-255.
Hey, can we do, I know it's like a, I love it because my guy won. It's like a presidential poll. It's a snapshot in time, okay? It means nothing because, as Joe likes to point out, 10th rounds change everything. But just a snapshot on 5 rounds right now, real quick, Tim O'Connell will win the world by over 100,000. We've just paid the average out today on 5 rather than 10. Tim O'Connell wins it. Tyler Wegesback wins it by 40 over Matt Reeves. Team Roping, Luke Brown and Jake Long win it over Dustin and Junior Nogata by about 40. Now the races start getting a little closer. In the saddle bronc riding, Jacobs would edge Ryder by about 11 and Jake Wright by about 18. So there's a race there to watch that just who stays on. Jake's ridden all of them. Both Jacobs and Ryder after tonight have come down. In the tie-down roping, there's a guy not even in the top five right now that could finish second in Matt Shizawa, okay? But right now, Hunter Heron would be your world champion over Matt by about 9. In the barrel racing, it would be Mary Berger over Lisa Lockhart by about $6,000. Amber Lee Moore could go from fifth. She's 18 grand out. The girl that came in 15th, if you pay it today, is within $18,000 of Mary Berger. Now, the bull riding, Sage needs to ride, because either Joe Frost or Shane Proctor. Right now, if you paid it out on 5, Sage wins it by 4,000 over Shane Proctor. 4,000. And only by 18,000 over Joe Frost. So those two guys named Proctor, because Frost has rode 4 of 5, Proctor's ridden 5 of 5, Sage has ridden 3. He doesn't have any bowls to give. If you're a Sage fan, you want to see him get to the whistle. But with 5 rounds left to go.
It's exciting stuff.
Yeah, there's
it's
a lot
exciting stuff. I think so as well.
You know, and that can be anybody, any combination. And you know, my initial comment is this is a membership organization, and it's not a union. We don't have a job. If the Dallas Cowboy football coach tells Dak Prescott and Ezekiel Elliott to jump, they say how far. If they tell me to jump, I just roll over and keep snoring.
So
you know,
because
I can go win
so
a day
like
money
this.
Riding bulls.
I got in a conversation about some of the sponsorships on my shirts at one of the rodeos that I work. Okay, and they were like, "Well, why should you be able to wear this on your shirt when I'm selling the sponsor or when I own the venue?" And I said, and this person had come from working with other professional sports, and I was like, "Well, listen. Jerry Jones owns the rights to Dak Prescott and Ezekiel Elliott. Okay, now if you want to own the rights to me, I'm for sale. I'll take them all off, but you're renting me. I'm a mule. Okay? This is a racetrack and you own all that's in it, but I'm a race car. You own this microphone. I won't say anything over this microphone that you don't want me to say. But as Boyd Paul Hamus, an individual, if I want to say Boyd Gaming or Prefert is my choice, even though Powder River is yours, I get to tell people Prefert's my choice. So we're members, but we're individuals too.
Right, and that's why you buy your membership. And nobody coerced you. You didn't have to qualify. If you got the stones to be able to back it up, buy your PRCA
okay,
so card
wait,
I want controversy.
No, I want to do this because Carl's hat's pretty tight right now. We've been bragging on him so much here, and I'm glad you're here, and he's here for one night. So I want to tell us something we don't, because then, Bob, there's more rodeo to talk about. But, Carl, tell us something we don't know. Is the Expos going to continue? Is the Champions Challenge going to continue? Is there a television deal? How long is that with CBS Sportsnet? Let's find out something.
This is the last year of the CBS Sportsnet contract. We are right in the middle of negotiations with it, and probably
with other people as well, Carl, or strictly with CBS.
Strictly with CBS Sports right now, and it probably be finished by. Well, there's a press conference tomorrow, and I suspect that by tomorrow morning it'll be finalized with the details, and that will be another 3-year deal on CBS.
Will you be contemplating a subscription service of any kind?
Well, I'm going to tell you, by next year, my goal is to have a WNFR television ourselves with the streaming piece on there. But technology is changing so fast in the streaming market that it's really difficult to know what the future looks like. So how long do you get involved in it? What's the platform you use? We have an international stream right now that we're doing. We tested.
So my question is as you negotiate with CBS, will there be, let's say Bud Paul Hamus in Sparta, Wisconsin, who's one of the biggest rodeo fans in the country. He wants to watch it, but he doesn't get CBS Sports on his cable or his satellite provider. Will there be an opportunity for him to spend $8 a night to get the Wrangler Network internet stream, where he could watch everything from the opening ceremonies, commercial free, okay, from the opening ceremonies, he gets to hear his son welcome the national. I mean, is that an opportunity that's going to be available to us in the new contract?
Well, part of what CBS has done in the past is control the rights to streaming. And that's the part that we are negotiating hard with them, is that they don't own the rights to it, because that is a piece that has value to the members of the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association. That's for sale. I'm just like you are. You know what? You want to give us the rights, you want to buy the rights, that's one thing. We think the rights have real value. That is inventory we've never used before, but it belongs to the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association and its members. So my goal is to continue this negotiation, and very frankly, that's where the stumbling block is. I want the rights because I want to do that, and they want to take them because they don't want us to stream parallel with their broadcast. They understand that deal. They want somebody to buy into a cable package that has CBS Sports. Guess what? I don't want that for the members of the PRCA. We are very, very close, and when we find out, I will tell you that probably the most likely scenario, and don't quote me on this one because I don't know. I'll know tomorrow by the time I go to that press conference at 3 o'clock, and that is that we will own our own rights, period. Now, there may be a delay because of the negotiations as to when you can watch it stream in the U.S. next year. You may have to tune in at 3 hours after the
performance. Or 10 o'clock the next morning,
exactly.
If you miss the night. Gotcha.
But you can archive that when you're streaming. You can archive that streaming so you can watch it anytime. So if you want to sit down and watch the tie-down roping from Tuesday night on Saturday, you have the right to do that. We should retain those rights, and we have probably been in negotiations for 4 months. It's another tough negotiation. If you and you guys know, if you ever negotiated with the TVs, with TV, they're brutal. You think Vegas was brutal? These guys.
Sometimes you can be on TV all the time, and then sometimes you disappear.
But let me tell you something. But here's the thing: you start looking at YouTube channels. There are YouTube channels that outperform the evening network news: ABC, NBC, CBS. Here's my point to Carl when I visited with him about it. And this is not trying to get into your pocket some more, but it is, okay? The bottom line is this is a product that you folks love and will consume, okay? I'm a Green Bay Packer fan. I spend $9 a month so that I can read. Shut up, Vikings. Hey, when you win a world championship, just one, not 13, just one. But anyway. But I pay $9 a month so I can read unvarnished reports on the Green Bay Packers. So I want to know who isn't playing well. I want to know if my GM is thinking about trading for somebody. I'm an inside baseball guy. I'm a Packer. So $9 a month, 12 months out of the year, call $120. But that's worth it to me. And what I say to Carl is there are 300,000 rodeo fans, I think, out there. I hope there is. That will give you $8 to $10 a month to have unvarnished stuff. Unvarnished. What's the truth, okay? And this is why this show works. This show works because it's unvarnished. You will not find politically correct in this show, okay? But, no, hey. Hey,
cheeks.
Buddy, we need to go bowling together on this one, all right? But because for the next time Carl comes back, because I've seen your social media feeds and I don't know how you feel about it, I'm wanting to discuss the potential of what Las Vegas Events has been championing, and that is a different type of payout on the final day of the National Finals Rodeo. We clearly don't have time tonight, but if we could get him back for that.
Let me make one comment about it because I think it's important that you understand this deal. The television numbers are so strong for the PRCA right now. You had 950,000 viewers on the 10th round last year on CBS. So. Average about 650,000 households throughout the National Finals Rodeo last year
but
10 nights.
But here's my
So if you just do the simple math, that is inventory that the members of the Professional Rodeo Cowboys own. And you have to pay an upcharge for CBS Sports Net on any cable channel. You think you don't, but look at your bill. You really do. So why shouldn't the PRCA retain those dollars to give back to their membership? Because we create that ourselves. So that's what we're working on for next year.
And that's a very, very businessman way of pointing out that right now we have to buy our time on television. I'd much rather have you buy what you want to watch, whether it's the short round of the Dodge City Roundup, the short round of the Fort Worth Stock Show and Rodeo. You buy what you want with those dollars going to 101 Rodeo Drive rather than to CBS headquarters in New York.
Okay. But the other thing, and I know you guys are, or I know you're out of time, but the one thing I think that we do need to do is continue to create television market, because that's important to our contestants, certainly in the marketplace. But what you may or may not understand is Fort Worth, Texas, the PRCA owns the right to Fort Worth, Texas when it's distributed too. So we own 640 rodeos that we can. We also have archives in Tulsa, Oklahoma of 1959 NFR. You could literally have a channel called PRCA Rodeo where you could get on there anytime you wanted to and bring up Cheyenne from 1986 and watch the bareback riding. I think that has huge value to the market of everybody.
This
and our
is what
families.
They work on whenever, you know, we're looking to see find a rodeo. It's not that easy, and especially with as many channels as just blown up on television to find out who's real, who's getting ratings, and it is a difficult deal. And I think you guys have been doing the last 2.5 years of the negotiations. I think we got a chance for them to start paying us like they should.
Okay, I do agree. I agree with that.
All right, Donnie, Bob has been sitting there patiently, and what has been nice about the PRCA is, and Carl knows this, we all do. Everybody that comes here wants to see rodeo and more rodeo product. And that's what Bob's going to talk about briefly here, the Boyd Gaming Shootout. I'm guessing, Carl, because I don't know when you heard about it, probably wasn't your favorite thing to hear about. But we have found there is room for everybody here, and it's not taking one ticket away from the National Finals Rodeo. So, Bob, if you will, just briefly tell us what's coming up starting Thursday.
Well, let me give you the highlights on this. When it came down, everybody had an opportunity to be in the conversation, and he was there as well. And Las Vegas Events went, let's roll. And he never raised his hands. I don't know about any of that kind of stuff. The one thing that he's in favor of, and is something that you and I have been a part of for 41 years, and I've rode for this brand, been a part of this brand, and I'm still breeding this brand 41 years later, is the fact that this is rodeo. We, at this level, are at the top. So as we find more room, more places, more venues, that we can exercise the option of this sport, from the bareback riding to the steer wrestling, Joe, pop off a couple little names. About 48 hours from now, in our beautiful arena, with comfortable chairs, I might say, you are going to watch these names and more. And this is what will happen. Doors open every day at 1 o'clock. 2 o'clock, it's showtime. 8 will go in every event on Thursday. 8 again on Friday. And then on Saturday, we go with 6 best, come back with 3 best. This is the Boyd Gaming Cinch Shootout. See this? Wrangler. I've been with these people 36 years. I'm a Wrangler guy, but I respect what Cinch has put their money for on the line. Everything that we do at the end of the day when they turn the lights out, this is a family with all peoples involved.
And what if, just looking forward, hopeful, what if this Boyd Gaming Shootout one day was PRCA sanctioned or endorsed and approved? Wouldn't we like it even just as much or more, right? And I can tell you that I know personally that even though Carl comes from the Wrangler brand, he knows having Cinch or Roper Apparel or Panhandle Slim or Ariat or anybody on board with the PRCA would be a good thing. So there's always ongoing dialogue, okay, about getting those people out there that currently aren't partners with the PRCA to be partners. Boyd Gaming is a partner. We partner with them year-round. We partner with them at the national finals. And hopefully in the near future, we'll be able to partner with them on this shootout.
Now, here's the cool deal. Of the 8 in each of these events, and this was the same format as last year, the 16th, we call it the crying hole in the industry, 17th, 18th, and 19th are already seated to come here. Then we pick the other 4 invitees. Pop me off some names there, Cowboy.
Little invitees, probably Bobby Moat in the bareback riding, Luke Branquino in the steer wrestling, Hunter Cure, Tyler Pearson, Bray Arms. How about a little team roping? Clay Trine and Jade Corkle, ever heard of them? Derek Begay, Clay O'Brien. We got in the saddle bronc, Chad Furley, Wade Sundell, Jesse Bale, tie down roping a little well unknown named Fred Whitfield, Monty Lewis, Clint Cooper, and then you got a little old barrel race, Lindsay Sears. Anybody heard of her? She's won a few. Bull riding. How about Chandler Bounds? You know, it's one after another. It's nobody's going to be a cakewalk.
It's a rodeo from 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock, and then you eat dinner, and then you go to the Wrangler National Finals Rodeo. It doesn't get a whole lot better than that. You know, in my mind, this is just more money for the Cowboys in this business and more entertainment. This is the NFR experience, and I just think it's great.
Well, I'm a native Nevadan, and all I can say is God bless Las Vegas and Clark County. But you have to understand, we had to give up some things, and we took some kicking in the crotches for some other things. And when it all settles and done, we're still going to tip a tall crowned hat, wear a pair of boots that make us cowboys and cowgirls.
Okay.
And that's what our life is
all
about.
I got one thing to add, and this is from a straight contestant's point of view. 4 or 5 years ago, all you heard was disgruntlement and what's Carl going to do for me next? What's Carl going to do? What's administration going to do? That's when we had really good finals and we won $100,000 if you just kicked them square in the bunghole every night. This man and his administration leadership have made the National Finals Rodeo to where when they get here now, they get $10,000 put in their pocket. They used to take it back out of what we won, no more. They've made the Wrangler Challenges where a guy can go if he's hurt and lay out, come back, and have a great run. And the National Finals now, what Donnie and I would have had loved to compete at this level, because you know what? You can have a mediocre finals and win $100,000. That's hats off to this guy right here and what he's done for rodeo.
Yeah.
Carl Stressman, would you give him a hand? Carl, thanks so much for being here with us. Everybody up here, thank you. Aren't you glad you came tonight? Good, good stuff that you won't find anywhere else. We're going to say goodbye here, but I want you to stay right where you're at. We have prizes to give away, a lot of great prizes. So let us run our closing credits, and we'll turn the lights back on, and we'll give away a lot of presents. Thank you so much for your time, for being here with us this evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you for watching and attending the show. We hope you enjoyed this presentation of the National Finals Tonight Show at the Orleans, where all the Cowboys go after the rodeo. We look forward to seeing you again tomorrow and remind you to join us for the 100th episode on December 10th. Same time, same place. We invite you to keep the party going at the legendary Buck and Ball. Head to the Buck and Ball Saloon for live music, dancing, beer and drink specials, and best of all, no cover charge. And one more reminder, get your tickets to the Cinch Boyd Gaming Shootout Rodeo December 8, 9, and 10 right next door. Prices start at $30.